O solo tá aqui.
Aí.
E aí, tudo bom?
Tudo, e você? Ah, então não vou compartilhar minha tela, não. Vou esperar você.
Tranquilo. Bom, pessoal, vamos começar? Vamos mandar bala e a gente sempre começou na hora para valer. Então, é muito bom que isso aqui vai. Conseguiu colocar no YouTube, meninas?
Sim, a gente está online pelo YouTube.
Ah, tá
Deixa eu ver
ótimo,
se
tá
assiste.
ótimo. Então, começar então, Marilene. Primeiro é falar aí a todos do curso. É muito bom que esse esteja gravado, né? Que o pessoal vai poder assistir depois, quem não puder participar online. E com isso a gente, você está iniciando, né? Reiniciando esse ciclo pós-pandemia ou impandemia, né?
Ainda durante a pandemia.
Isso, como nós fazíamos esses seminários presencialmente, embora fosse transmitido. Nós acabamos dando um intervalo nele, mas a ideia agora é retomar. Agradeço muito, Marilene. Você vai se apresentar, né, com detalhes, mas agradeço muito sua disponibilidade em tão pouco tempo, está pronta para a gente mandar bala. E o fato é que agora a gente já tem aí, com esse início, uma grade já com seis novas, nas próximas 6 semanas já temos palestrantes. Novamente aí, lembrando ao pessoal do curso, principalmente quem está no final do doutorado, né, que se inscreva também para fazer as suas apresentações. De forma, Marilene, que é um prazer ter você. Você vai apresentar em inglês, né?
Eu vou apresentar em inglês, se for tudo bem.
Tá ótimo. Pode mandar bala. Eu vou tirar aqui meu vídeo e manda bala. Muito obrigado.
Beleza. Eu vou tirar meu vídeo também e eu vou sharear minha tela e aí me avisem se tiver algum problema com o áudio, alguma coisa aí. Vamos ver então. Tá todo mundo vendo?
Sim, perfeito.
Tá ótimo, então. Então vamos começar. First, I want to start with a big thank you, Professor Gonçalo, for inviting me. It's been really exciting to develop my PhD thesis together with you as a student of Unicamp, and with my awesome co-advisors, Dr. Simone Souza, who is here already, and Dr. Carolina Grassi. I also want to thank you all for taking this time to listen to my presentation. I have my contacts here. Let me try to put the pointer, pointer options, yes. Okay, I have my contacts here, my website, my Twitter, and my email as well. Please feel completely free to get in touch after this for whatever questions that you might have. And I really hope that you get very interested so we can keep in touch after this. I'll start by talking a little bit about me. I'm from São Paulo, born and raised in São Paulo. I'm a biologist and I got my undergrad degree at Unicamp. And then I got a master's degree in molecular biology at the University of São Paulo. I also hold a specialization in strategic management of technological innovation via Unicamp as well. And before LanzaTech, I've worked as a researcher to Monsanto Company in Campinas. I was working in the department of sugarcane first and then soy breeding, again with molecular biology. I've also worked at Braskem. And there is where I met Carolina, also as a researcher in the fields of metabolic engineering, synthetic biology, and lab automation. In 2016, I moved to Boston, invited to integrate Professor Douglas Densmore's lab as a researcher fellow. And my main roles there were to develop experimental tools as microfluidics, DNA assembly methodologies, software, hardware, everything for synthetic biology. So it was a pretty mixed group And I was one of the only biologists in this group. So I had to talk with different backgrounds, different people from all of the world. It was a really nice experience. After that, I moved to Chicago. Now I'm working as a scientist at LanzaTech. I'm part of the synthetic biology group, working to engineer our microorganisms at scale. In Chicago with me are my husband. And fun fact, he has already worked with Professor Gonzalo before. And Professor Gonzalo used to call him Soneca. So I guess work is not actually what he was doing there. And I have my cat with me as well. And now I'll talk about the company itself, the company that I work today, which you already know at this point, that is called LanzaTech. And our mission here is to build a carbon smart world, a world where we can choose where the carbon in your products, in your personal belongings comes from. So about the company started in New Zealand in 2005 by co-founder Dr. Sean Simpson and moved to the US in 2010 when CEO Jennifer Holmgren joined us. This year we are celebrating its 15th anniversary, and today we have operation and business offices in China and India. And here in the United States, we have our labs and offices here in Skokie, Illinois. Skokie is kind of a suburb of Chicago. And we have plants and offices in Georgia as well. Georgia is more related with jet fuel. As you might know at this point, bioenergy creates jobs. So we are more than 150 people here in US and India and China working the company. And we are spread out over biotechnology, engineering, business, computing, process, fermentations, everything. The IP portfolio of LanzaTech, just out of curiosity, relies on more than 750 patents and more than 400 pending applications. Two things that have been very precious to keep the company up and running after these 15 years of its foundation are, first, money, of course. We got so far 4 rounds of funding that sum more than $390 million. One thing that I can guarantee you is that we don't waste money here. So what I want to say with that is that that's what it costs to launch a disruptive technology. It's an expensive process. Innovation is usually an expensive process. Disruptive innovation is an expensive process. And here we have our partners who are helping us shaping the company, building our expertise, shaping its future. And we strongly believe, actually, it's not a belief, it's a fact, that there's no way you can commercialize a product, scale up a product without having partnerships for it. All these people have knowledge that we don't have, of course, and they bring it to the table. When people talk about reducing emissions, they usually think, let's keep the carbon in the ground. Do not extract carbon anymore. Do not use them anymore. But this is actually pretty hard to do. How we are going to do it if a lot of what we use is fossil fuel based? We have the tires of our cars, our pens, computers, etc. This is all based in carbon from fossil fuels. Ideally, what we could do, we should go to the store and be able to choose between what was made from new carbon or what was carbon recycled. So I want to start with the idea that we must think that carbon is precious, so we have to segment where we use it. For example, we do not need carbon for energy. Energy can be carbon free. I mean, why you would use fossil fuels when you could simply build solar farms, wind farms, use hydropower, and so on? Now, by definition, we cannot get rid of carbon for chemicals. We need carbon for aviation fuel, for example. Everyday products need carbon. So let's save the carbon that we have for fuels and chemicals that we need, but keeping in mind that carbon is a recyclable material that is precious enough to worth recycling it. And that's exactly what LanzaTech does. We are carbon recyclers. Now let's think about fermentation. Let me grab some water here. It's pretty dry here. You are used to fermentation of sugar, right? You are used to an organism that takes carbon from a sugar molecule and makes ethanol. What do? We have a bacteria that uses carbon monoxide. That's all it needs. If it has carbon monoxide, it can make ethanol. The technology is pretty interesting because if you are working with sugar fermentation, you have your reactor, you dissolve sugar in it, you put your microorganism, and you produce your ethanol. But carbon monoxide is not soluble in water. So what we've got to do is to create enough turbulence to get enough CO so the organism can use it. So it's not only the microorganism that is unique, it's the whole bioreactor, it's the whole system that has to be adapted for this to work. In our company, we want to use waste and transform it into something valuable. And this something valuable can be ethanol for cars. We can make via chemical conversion jet fuel. You can think about the whole ethylene market as well and all the products that can come from there. The bacteria biomass that we remove from the tank, from the bioreactor, can be converted in animal food. It's being converted in animal food. And the reason for that, why do we want to do that? Is that pollution is, of course, already affecting our health. And not only this, though the Paris Agreement set the limits in 2 Celsius degrees, we are in a trajectory to get to 4 Celsius degrees of increasing temperature if we do nothing. This range of warming turns out to be almost impossible to even adapt. This means less land and less suitable climate to plant. Sea level rises, and this is a fundamental change in the ecosystem and the way we live. Also, we want to use not only industrial off gases, but also other waste feedstock. Think in agriculture waste. Think in municipal solid waste. Now, This is a 100,000 gallon per year pilot plant. This was built in China at a steel mill. Steel mill, if I remember correctly, is translated for, if someone can help me with that, it's maybe metallurgic. But it literally takes the steel mill gases before they go out the flute and convert them in our bioreactor. So there are pipes that go, that connect the industry and pump these gases through these pipes until our bioreactor. We just shove them into a bioreactor. We compress them in that, if you will. Sorry about this picture. This is terrible. It's not. but I couldn't find another better one for that. But it does the job. The data that you are seeing here is a couple of compressor failures when our bug, which you are seeing here, continue kept stable even with these two failures. At high productivity, that you cannot see here, and high selectivity. Here we are talking about 70%, but today we are in 90% already of selectivity for ethanol. This was the moment that we thought that we could scale up even more the process and go commercial. So still in China, our first commercial plant was launched at the end of 2018 with capacity to produce around 20 million gallon ethanol per year. We've produced so far more than 13 million gallons of ethanol over more than 6,000 hours of continuous operation. That means that as of today, we could avoid more than 7,000 tons of CO2 emissions. Any questions so far? So I can drink some water. Right. So why we believe we offer the optimal carbon monoxide solution? If you release this carbon monoxide directly into the atmosphere, this is a highly toxic gas. It oxidizes quickly to CO2 in atmosphere. And if you flare it to CO2, this CO2, of course, is going to contribute directly to climate change. If you burn it, you also generate and release a significant amount of CO2 to the atmosphere. Now, if you convert it with high efficiency, this sequestration can be transformed into products and low carbon fuels and not in pollution. Okay, let's take a step back. I was talking about carbon monoxide before, but we are not only talking about CO here. We have to think of our technology to be flexible enough to be a whole cycling, a whole recycling platform where you can also use CO2. Where you can also use hydrogen in any mixture of those. The pool of feedstock is huge. We were talking about municipal solid waste, we were talking about sugarcane residues, other agriculture residues, we were talking about gases. You could use our technologies, not only in steel mills, you can use our technology in refineries. So the pool of feedstock is huge. And also you can start to think about gasification. So the blend of gases and the ratio can vary a lot. You can take biomass as a solvent and gasify it to syngas. You have CO, you have hydrogen, and you'll be able to use it. That's the idea. And that's what we want to do. All through the same type of equipment, all through the same type of fermenter. The advantage of our bug is that it can be very adaptable to different gases composition rates. This is a huge shift in the game, I would say. Because you can surpass some cleaning process, you can use different streams. And this first one was already demonstrated at scale, and it reflects the composition of the gases coming from that steel mill that I showed you before. We also have already demonstrated that we can produce ethanol at a scale by using syngas from municipal waste via gasification. We gasify this waste and we produce syngas and we produce ethanol. And we also demonstrated at pilot scale that we can produce ethanol by using gases of our refinery. This is specifically being built, or was built in China. Sorry, India. So talking a little bit about environmental impact, just as of a fact, every time we make a ton of ethanol from these gases, we prevent 5 barrels of gasoline to needing to be made. So we are keeping this carbon in the ground. If we use all the ethanol that we can produce specifically for vehicle fuel based on some of our life cycle assessments, we could fuel 100,000 cars per year. And at the same time, we could save emissions of another 80,000. What it means? It means over 80% of carbon dioxide reduction over gasoline. For urban waste gasification, we developed a partnership with Sekisui in Japan and Sumitomo Chemical to manufacture polyolefins. This project has already more than 40,000 hours of operation and can process 425 tons of municipal solid waste per day to produce ethanol. I guess, in my opinion, the most interesting part of this process is that this waste doesn't need to be sorted. So if you are thinking in different realities where you don't have a proper way to sort out your waste, you are still covered by the technology. And this is only an introduction to tell you that we are very keen to get this technology working, not only under perfect conditions, but also under variable conditions and also in remote places. This project has been demonstrating consistent performance. It is highly robust, even in face of syngas fluctuations. It is a high producer. It is consistently utilizing gases above targets. And our selectivity today, it's on 95% for ethanol. Another very cool step that we introduced in this project very recently was that we could recycle 90% of the water that we are using in this process without any impact in the productivity. And this is, of course, means that we are leaving a lower environmental footprint. This is my favorite part, it's gasification. So gasification allows you to work with different feedstocks. So as I told you before, we want to be in different places under different conditions. So we want to use the feedstock that is available in that condition. So we can gasify biomass. Think about agriculture waste. So think that each country, and even inside a country, each region produces a different type of agriculture waste. Together with these two partners, we could adapt our technology to integrate gasification units and use these gases in our fermenters to produce the chemicals that we want. And you are thinking here, not only in huge facilities, but we want to make this less complex, less expensive, and more affordable as well. Facilities that are compact enough, cheap enough to be adapted to different regions, different needs, and different ecosystems. Our goal here is to reduce our CapEx in up to 25% and the OPEX in up to 15%. This is the kind of improvements that can deploy technology in remote locations. We have an integrated biomass plant here, there in India, with 4,000 hours of operation, and one here in US with 10,000 hours of operation, demonstrating consistent ethanol production as well. We are building plants globally, which is very exciting. We are building one in Belgium with ArcelorMittal. We are building one in India in a refinery. As I told you before, we are building one in South Africa in a ferroalloy plant, as well as we are gasifying biomass here in the United States. And what all these places have in common, and that's really key for our technology and for our business plan, is that all of them rely on a variety of carbon-rich gases that would normally be wasted or underutilized, that would go to the atmosphere as a waste. So we want to be feedstock agnostic. We want to be region agnostic. We want to access the carbon that is being wasted and produce ethanol. Just an example, if we could access all recycle, all the carbon, the global carbon waste, that would be equivalent of getting rid of 700 million cars off the road. We always say here that, and we try to keep this in mind, that a lot of inventions were actually treated with pessimism, even by brilliant people in the past, and they were wrong. And we like to think that this is because often these predictions are extrapolations from the past of what we already knew. The truth is that innovation in bioenergy has already changing things. If we could use all the carbon in these types of feedstocks, whether they be residues or whether they be industrial waste, we could make on the order of billions of gallons of ethanol. So it is possible. People would think that it wasn't possible before to sequester and recycle this carbon, but it is possible, it is happening, and more can be done. So that's how we think ethanol. We think ethanol as a building block of the future. So I was telling you that we could do billions of gallons of ethanol if we could use and recycle all the carbon. But we know that there's way more ethanol that we might need. We should think on ethanol of being a substrate for making future products. Ethanol is a liquid. That's a huge advantage. It's easy to transport it. So you can produce it in remote areas and transport it. Today, as I showed you, we produce ethanol in China. We transport this ethanol back to the US, and we use this ethanol in Georgia to produce jet fuel. And in such a scale that we could use this fuel to fly from Orlando to Gatwick in London in a Virgin flight. Again, this is not only possible, this was not only possible, but it was possible to be done using the ethanol that we produced as a feedstock. What else do we can do with ethanol? Well, our entire chemical industries are based on ethylene, right? You can make polyethylene, you can make PEP, you can make PVC. All of these things starting from ethanol, and ethanol that you can produce by recycling carbon. That is what we think that is important way to how you can think about utilizing residues. And then we want to make a transition also to convert this carbon monoxide, or this carbon, if you will, in other products as well, not only ethanol, but beyond ethanol. So far, we apply it directed evolution to make this bug to produce ethanol efficiently, but we hadn't modified it genetically, had not. This bacteria was actually genetically inaccessible until very recently. I'm pretty sure a lot of you researchers can relate to that, to this suffering. But the synthetic biology team worked to develop genetic tools to modify it and to modify it efficiently. Now, this is another game changing. Now we are working to actually modify it to make new products. And in fact, we already have a modified microorganism stable enough and using media cheap enough to go to a commercial plant and produce isopropanol. The idea here is that you could easily interchange in your hardware the microorganism in your reaction. So you could produce what you need at that moment in a given situation on demand just by changing the organism. So I want to produce isopropanol. You go there and change it. It has to be this flexible. That's what we pursue. This is another project that we have. So we already can produce PET using our ethanol, which are produced via carbon recycling. This is pretty exciting. This is great. But we also working to produce MEG using synthetic biology to modify our microorganisms directly from waste gases. The team has already proven that we can do it. The next step for it now is to scale the process. Besides the fact that we'll be reusing the waste feedstock, the waste gases, we will also be surpassing some steps in the supply chain. And this is particularly important now, because if you think about the COVID situation, we had a lot of different problems in a lot of different areas with a lot of different problematic results because of problems in our supply chain. So if you can avoid to have these steps, in your supply chain, that would be fantastic. So that's what we want to do as well, as part of this project. Here I'm showing how we are thinking circular economy. That's our vision for a true circular economy. You have your plastic, let's start here. You have your plastic, you use your plastic. The plastic goes waste. This waste is collected and either goes to a mechanical recycling if it is appropriate, because not all plastic waste is suitable for mechanical recycling, or it is gasified. And we use these gases to produce more ethanol. And we use this ethanol to produce more plastic, and we close the loop. That's our vision for a truly circular economy, where you don't have to stop to use what you are using, but you have to reuse it. You have to recycle. You have to avoid this carbon to be waste. Now let's think a little bit about what it takes to go from an idea to something that is a commercial reality and is being deployed in many parts of the world. First, it takes a lot of data, and we use this data in integrated modules and algorithms in our systems. And this is truly spread out among very different levels. So for example, I work in the synthetic biology group. I work with scale up of generic engineering. So that being said, we are constructing and testing hundreds of thousands of microorganisms, different constructs to find the best producer. But how you analyze, how you collect and you analyze and you learn from this data that you are collecting. That's how we do it. So we collect all this data and with integrated models and algorithms, we analyze them. We also analyze data that has been collected from 5 different pilot and demo units outside the lab. Data that is being used to design new reactors, like this one, to optimize and scale up our process. We got to protect our intellectual property. So as I showed you in the first slide, this is something that we really praise. And all we started with an industrially proven host strain that today we can modify genetically to produce other chemicals other than ethanol. So this is in one figure how we deal with everything that is happening now in the company. So again, let's take a step back. I usually not very good with putting the slides in the right order. I told you before that we are working to reduce our costs. To make our process simpler and cheaper to get it to work in remote areas. But now, if you can work with a less expensive system, other thing that you can put this money in other things, in somewhere else. So for example, you can buy another piece of metal, an electrolyzer, and instead of using CO, hydrogen stream, you could also use carbon dioxide stream to feed the same technology. Electrolysis is becoming increasingly interesting because of the availability of low carbon power. We discussed this before. So what you are doing here is you are storing these electrons in liquid by doing something like this. This is going to be an important that part of our future. As an example, let's think about Brazil use sugarcane to produce ethanol. Some of this carbon ends up as CO2. This is normal in the process. Now imagine that you can couple that with a cheap chain of electrons and an electrolyzer and recycle all the CO2 using the whole existing infrastructure that you already have to produce ethanol from sugarcane to do it. You could add millions of gallons of ethanol to your production. That's what we want. We don't want any waste. We want more production. And we want to use the infrastructure that already exists in the places that are already working. We want to use the same structure that I assume you might have. We want to take the most advantage of the structure and the infrastructure that a sugarcane facility might have. So that was to say that we really think in our technology as a platform. You don't change this piece. The idea is not to change this piece. This piece should stay the way it is. You compress a gas and you take it all through your products. You take all through ethanol. We can start with the industrial gases. You can also gasify. If you are using CO2, you can incorporate another piece of metal to diversify your input gas stream. You can use your CO2. Of course, people are working in direct air capture to capture the CO2. So we are not married to one feedstock. This can change. This part here, this can change. It's just a matter to adapt upstream to the fixed platform. We must enable a variety of feedstock to produce different products. So not only ethanol, beyond ethanol, and to produce different chemicals that you might want to produce that is not ethanol. And this ethanol should be feasible to be used in cars, to be fuel grade. It should be feasible to be converted in jet fuel, in packaging test tube, which we already are launching, and to do whatever you want. Talk a little bit about our business model, give you an overview of our business model and how this is working today. And again, flexibility here is key to be successful. All right, so this is how our business model works today. So we have this core, we have engineers, we have biologists. And if you have the feedstock, we can start from the feedstock. We can test the gases coming from this feedstock for its production. We can evaluate the economic feasibility of producing it, the technological feasibility of using it and produce renewable chemicals. If it is competitive enough, we can move forward and work together to deliver a suitable process design. Now, let's say that you don't have a feedstock, but you know which molecule you want to produce. You want to use a determined and a specific chemical produced by our technology, by recycling carbon. We will work together on the technical economic evaluation. We are going to work together with our synthetic biology team to evaluate if it's possible to produce it, the feasibility of producing it. And if possible, and if possible, construct and deliver a new microbe specific for that product that you want to produce. Again, because of the way we built this business model, we can accelerate the deployment either of process design. We can deliver a suitable and on-demand process design, or we can design a whole new microbe. And because of this versatility, we can also adapt the model and platform for different realities. Carbon needs to be part of how we think about life. Our carbon footprint. Everything we do every day, we should ask ourselves, what is its carbon footprint? We've talked a lot about aviation, but aviation itself is only 2% of our global carbon footprint. Apparel or clothes are 8%. So the idea is to create a world where you can choose by the carbon footprint. You do not have to stop to fly. You don't have to stop to use plastic, but you could or you should have the option to take the one with the smallest carbon footprint. And this is what our Carbon Smart trademark is about. Consumer choices drive change. So we have now a trademark that is going to the packaging or whatever is suitable, that are going to inform the consumer that was produced via carbon recycling. That's our trademark. That's what we want to put out to the world, to inform people that product was made by carbon recycling. Back to the beginning, back to the carbon recycling. A steel mill makes steel, of course, and there is some carbon that is wasted in form of gases. We can take this carbon in and reuse it to make ethanol for cars, to convert it to make jet fuel for planes. You can also start to think in recycling this carbon from durable goods. The fundamental change here is to think in carbon as part of the circular economy, and not to think about the products as part of the circular economy, but the carbon itself. So that's how we want to put the carbon in the circular economy, to shift this mindset of products to actually carbon. So this is what I have about LanzaTech. I have an extra slides to briefly talk about my PhD. It's a high level picture of what I want to pursue in my PhD thesis. Hopefully I'll get it. So I truly believe that we can make that ethanol can be a global platform to substitute oil. So it doesn't matter how you produce it. It doesn't matter where you live, you will have a way to produce ethanol. So I want to take a look in the production. What we should to consider in order to make ethanol a global platform? What is the source that we are going to use? So it's biomass, it's first generation, it's sugarcane for first generation ethanol. Is this more suitable in this country? No, we don't have land to plant sugarcane, so it's waste gases. It is via waste, urban waste gasification. What is it? How this distribution would look like? So which are the logistics in place? Which are the infrastructure in place? What needs to be developed? Which technology is more suitable for each reality? It is carbon recycling as LanzaTech. It is 2G technology. It is first generation policies. Which are the policies that are being successful in drive and incentivize both ethanol production and ethanol adoption? Which ones are missing? Utilization. Is this chain or this kind of production more suitable for export, or this place, this region, and this country has already the need for internal usage of ethanol? Which technologies may benefit from ethanol? Which final product this region is needing? And finally, the impact. What do we want to consider in terms of impact? Is this country in need of more jobs, of rural development, in taking care of their waste to adapt or to adopt better waste management procedures? Is it about health? Do you want to prevent these particles to impact your health? Are we thinking about sustainability? I guess the answer is yes for everything, right? So what we are doing in terms of reducing emissions and tackling climate change. And coming from Brazil, I really want this to be focused in developing countries. So I want to focus all these questions in Brazil, South Africa, and Southeast Asia, because they are developing countries, but different enough that we have a good average on how to demonstrate that ethanol can actually be a global platform that can be produced everywhere. That's what I have. I guess I took too long. Sorry about that. But I'm more than glad to take your questions, and also any comments or any, please feel free to send me an email if you want. I can put the email here in the comments again. And yeah, let's keep in touch and talk more about it. Thank you.
Marilene, excelente, excelente, e esse slide final aí realmente mostrando que a gente pode ter o etanol, né, como uma molécula do futuro, não só para um uso ou dois, mas para absolutamente todos os usos, né?
Virtually anywhere and for all uses, yes, para todos os usos, Ed, desculpa.
Para todos os usos, você ter feito em inglês. Alguns comentários. Primeiro, eu conheço a LanzaTech desde 2011, se não me engano, quando eu tive com a CEO. Eu fiquei muito impressionado com a empresa. Naquele início, era uma coisa assim que boa parte das pessoas não acreditava que seria possível fazer essa fermentação gasosa, né, de forma eficiente. Hoje tem...
É por isso que eu deixo assim, claro, que durante a apresentação, que realmente as pessoas não acreditavam nisso.
Não acreditavam de jeito nenhum. Agora você vê, primeiro, uma coisa só para eu estressar um ponto que você falou, você tem já uma unidade na China operando comercialmente, e é uma unidade grande, não é uma planta piloto, uma unidade de demonstração, uma unidade gigantesca.
Não, Gonçalo, é uma unidade comercial que a gente produz em nível comercial e que a gente usa o etanol já para produzir jet fuel.
Perfeito. Então, quer dizer, já passou muito. Vai dar certo, não vai dar certo. LanzaTech já deu certo. Aí agora a gente tem um outro aspecto que eu acho que é muito importante que o pessoal perceba, quando você colocou aquelas rodadas de investimento. Quer dizer, lança até uma empresa de enorme sucesso, mas ela é uma startup de alta tecnologia. Se você perguntar, ela dá caixa? Não, ela não dá caixa. Não dá ainda.
Ainda não.
Mas vai dar. E isso é típico da inovação disruptiva. Ninguém imagine que uma inovação... O próprio Tesla, né? Um carro... Caixa zero, caixa negativo. Né?
Nossa, Gonçalo, você foi no ponto agora, porque é caro. Então, assim, esse dinheiro que eu mostrei para vocês... É, de novo, a gente não gasta dinheiro à toa aqui. Então, é caro. A gente, apesar de ter uma planta comercial já deployed, a gente ainda é considerado startup, porque foi o que você falou. A gente não tem caixa ainda. Então, assim, é uma luta diária para conseguir mais investimento. Agora, um pouco mais fácil, porque quando você mostra que está funcionando, aí é um game changing. Então, para as pessoas apostarem naquela tecnologia, é um pouco mais fácil. Mas ainda é difícil conseguir dinheiro, principalmente quando você pensa em baixo preço de petróleo, de Covid, o pessoal não está voando e coisas assim. Mas é o que você falou, Gonçalo, ainda não dá
dinheiro. Só uma coisa, Marlene, eu vou ter que sair em 4 minutos, mas Simone, você está aí, não está?
Estou aqui, Gonçalo.
Eu vou botar sua câmera aí, você vai assumir aí aqui. Porque
estou com um companheiro aqui, ó.
Ah, então ótimo.
Oh.
É isso aí, é o dia atual.
Bom, se a gente precisar encerrar também, mas, de novo.
Não,
e-mail
eu
tá.
Acho que continuar mais uns 5 ou 10 minutos até o pessoal. Ah. Mas o que eu queria dizer é o seguinte, Marlene: isso aí que vocês estão fazendo, além de ser do ponto de vista científico, uma coisa maravilhosa, né? O trabalho com clostrídeos, né? Espécie
isso,
de...
é clostrídeo.
Isso é uma coisa maravilhosa, extraordinária do ponto de vista científico, mas a LanzaTech é uma lição de o que significa inovação, né, nessa área de biotecnologia, e é isso que o Brasil tem que aprender. Ninguém imagine que emprestando dinheiro a juros, né, existe garantia do inovador, do empreendedor, você vai conseguir fazer... inovação disruptiva. Não dá.
E, Gonçalo, não só dinheiro, paciência também. A empresa está com 15 anos. Agora que a gente está comercial.
Você só vai ter paciência se você tiver conhecimento. Se você não tiver conhecimento. Então, o Brasil, esse blá, blá, blá de inovação, ele só vai existir quando a gente alterar a nossa cultura. Nós deixarmos...
Em parceria, né, Gonçalo?
Antes, né, de comerciantes, que compra hoje para vender amanhã, tendo uma margenzinha pequenininha, para entender que você tem que fazer investimentos, round de investimento de longo prazo, investir para valer em conhecimento, só vai dar certo, né? Só vai começar a gerar recursos daqui a 10 anos, mas aí você vai ter um para valer, olha.
E sugar conhecimento do primeiro mundo também, com parceria.
Pois é, e uma coisa que você falou, eu não tinha me tocado, que agora eu ficou claro para mim, não sei se o Davi eu acho que está pelo YouTube, eu vi o Davi no YouTube, mas uma coisa que você falou e que eu acho que é muito importante, ó, quando você tem etanol de primeira e segunda geração, a fermentação, ela gera CO2 com praticamente 100% de pureza. A gente poderia pegar esse CO2, colocar placas solares, né, para produzir elétrico e fazer uma conversão para a produção de mais
etanol. Mais etanol, exatamente.
Etanol, até que eu queria depois discutir com você para ver se vai possível montar um projeto nisso aí.
Nossa, é um ciclo eterno,
com certeza.
Né?
Um ciclo eterno, exatamente, não deixar vazar.
No fundo, tudo vem do sol, né? Ou se vem agora, ou se vem no passado, ou se vem... Mas eu acho que a gente vai... Eu quero ver com o Davi, que o Davi tem um projeto parecido com isso, com a Hytron. Eu acho que a gente poderia ativar, né? Um 1G, 2G, LanzaTech, que seria sensacional. Fazer sempre outra coisa. O RenovaBio, quando você enterra CO2, né, quando você realmente reduz o CO2 para valer, ele começa a dar o dobro de CBios por tonelada realmente. Pessoal, parabéns, Marlene, excelente, e muito obrigado novamente pelo excelente seminário e por ter sido a pioneira aí desse novo ciclo.
Obrigada,
muito
pelo
bom
convite.
Mesmo. Excelente mesmo.
A gente não pode mais atrasar a reunião, né? Em casa
não. Não, agora não tem mais desculpa, né, Gonçalo?
Um abraço, pessoal. Parabéns. Tchau, tchau.
Até mais. Tchau, Gonçalo. Muito bom, Marlene. Tchau. Muito bom mesmo. Tchau.
Obrigada, Simone.
Você não está na reunião? Eu estou. Você vê, né? Eu tenho companhia.
Que bonitinho.
Deixa eu fazer uma pergunta. Eu sei que a gente já está claro, para terminar as duas, né? Mas é... Bom, primeiramente, meus parabéns, a apresentação foi super clara, eu acho
Obrigada, Simone. Eu
entendi muito mais agora da LanzaTech, mas ao mesmo tempo que eu entendi mais, também me vieram mais perguntas.
Ótimo.
Sobre o que é. Uma dúvida que me ficou é em relação às tecnologias que são, que a LanzaTech possui uhum. as tecnologias que ela possui. Por exemplo, no início você mostrou um slide com as várias parcerias, né, que vocês possuem com diversas empresas, né, e você ressaltou que é importante, né, essa parceria, achei interessante. Agora, ao longo da apresentação você mostrou tecnologias, né, dentre elas gasificação, né, você comentou muito da questão da conversão do resíduo sólido municipal em etanol. Essas tecnologias todas a LanzaTech detém ou ela vem via parceria com aqueles parceiros que você indicou no comecinho da apresentação?
Nossa, essa é uma ótima pergunta, Simone, porque o que acontece é exatamente o que eu mostrei lá. A gente não consegue, a gente não tem tudo aqui in-house, a gente não tem toda a expertise, a gente não tem toda a infraestrutura, então... Para desenvolver novas tecnologias e para fazer o scale-up, a gente tem que fazer essas parcerias. Então, respondendo a sua pergunta mais especificamente, quando eu digo para você naquele outro slide, mais para o final, essa parte deve ser fixa e o resto a gente adapta, essa parte fixa, o micróbio e o bioreactor, isso é o core da LanzaTech. Agora, quando você pensa em gasificação, eletrólise a gente está desenvolvendo in-house também, mas também em parceria. Mas quando você pensa em gasificação de resíduo, isso a gente está fazendo em parceria. Isso a gente não tem o conhecimento, a infraestrutura in-house. Então, quando eu mostro naquele slide que tem a parte fixa e a parte flexível, a parte flexível é o que a gente não tem. Então, entendi. A parte fixa é o que a gente tem.
Uhum. Entendi. Não, ótimo. Mas mesmo assim, né, para uma startup, Marlene, para uma startup abraçar tantas tecnologias, né, e ter um know-how para desenvolvimento é absolutamente interessante, né, inovador. Acho que o Rafael quer fazer uma pergunta.
Isso, Marilene, deixa eu colocar aqui a minha câmera. Isso. Prazer, parabéns pela apresentação. Como eu comentei inicialmente, eu estou aqui até por conta do professor Joaquim Seabra, eu sou aluno dele. Nós já tivemos uma oportunidade de trabalhar um tempo atrás com a LanzaTech. O interesse nosso era a parte biocombustível de aviação, mas a produção do etanol intermediário era da Lanza. Então, só queria, rapidamente, eu sei que a gente já está no final, só um comentário.
Claro.
O carbono, principalmente quando se produz etanol a partir de gás de aciaria, o carbono, no caso do Brasil, e com certeza na China, ele tem origem fóssil, né? No Brasil, a gente tem aí uma parcela do carbono que é carvão vegetal, só que mais de 80% das siderúrgicas, né, das steel mills brasileiras, ainda é baseado em coque e tal. Então,
siderúrgica, não metalúrgica, obrigada.
Isso, Mas, assim, de uma forma ou de outra, mesmo produzindo um etanol para ser queimado num carro, ou produzindo etanol para você fazer um jet fuel para ser queimado numa turbina de avião, de uma forma ou de outra, este carbono ele vai para a atmosfera. E esse carbono que está nesse etanol produzido de um gás de aciaria que vem de um carvão fóssil, ele vai voltar para a atmosfera. Então, é só uma colocação assim, o primeiro ponto. É como que fica a ideia da reciclagem, ou pelo menos das vantagens ambientais, eu acho que está mais no sentido assim de você aproveitar os waste streams, né? Evitar de queimar aquele querosene fóssil, evitar de queimar aquela gasolina. Perfeito. Mas isso daí, quando você faz um balanço, um carbon footprint, É claro, existem algumas técnicas metodológicas, você pode cancelar e tal, mas esse carbono vai voltar para a atmosfera, de um jeito ou de outro, ou na ponta do flare, ou na ponta da turbina do avião, né? Isso é um primeiro ponto.
Perfeito.
Agora, o segundo ponto, acho que foi um dos colegas que perguntou no chat do YouTube, esse processo de fermentação, ele não gera CO2? A quantidade de gás que entra, a quantidade de gás... Por causa que, quando você considera que o seu gás de entrada é um gás de aciaria, e a aciaria vem de combustível fóssil, então existe aí um escape de combustível fóssil. Claro, uma parcela dele vai produzir etanol, que vai substituir gasolina e tal.
Isso, é. A ideia é que você consiga fazer o máximo que você consegue, né? Então, por exemplo, quando eu estava falando de, por exemplo... Você tem uma facility de sugarcane produzindo etanol de primeira geração. Então, claro, na fermentação e em outros processos, você está produzindo CO2 também. Então, a ideia é que você, no mundo ideal, você, mesmo com a questão da turbina do avião e tudo mais, que você conseguiria, via direct air capture, você conseguiria pegar todo esse CO2. Então, esse é o mundo ideal, né? E transformar em etanol. Então, no caso da usina de cana-de-açúcar, o que você poderia fazer para aproveitar esse CO2 vindo da fermentação é justamente produzir mais etanol a partir desse CO2 que seria liberado. Então, assim, é entendível que o mundo perfeito vai demorar para a gente alcançar, de que algum CO2 vai para a atmosfera. A questão é o quanto você consegue evitar que ele vá para a atmosfera, para você ficar num nível que você consiga evitar essas mudanças de temperatura, né? Esses warming.
Nessas rotas, para encerrar mesmo, nessas plantas comerciais, no caso da China, você tem esse valor, o percentual de venting que você tem, ou 50%, 20%, não sei.
Eu não tenho, eu posso conseguir para você, a gente pode continuar em contato, porque claro, isso não é confidencial, eu só não tenho mesmo, nem aqui escrito, nem on top of my head, mas a gente continua em contato e a gente continua conversando, eu consigo esses dados para você. Mas eu realmente não lembro, eu não tenho aqui.
Passa esse carro.
Tá certo. Parabéns, boa sorte no doutorado.
Ai, obrigada.
Muito legal, muito legal. Boa sorte mesmo.
Obrigada.
Obrigado, Simone, pelo espaço.
Marilene, obrigada pela apresentação. Se você ainda tiver alguns minutinhos, a gente gostaria de fazer as perguntas do YouTube.
Ah, eu tenho sim. Vamos ver se eu consigo respondê-las. Mas eu já avisei que eu não vou participar da minha reunião, da próxima reunião.
A primeira é do Jaime Figueruti. E ele pergunta como está a evolução do sistema de transporte e adição de sólidos para reatores de produção de syngas.
That's a good question. Eu não sei. Isso é uma pergunta para engenharia, então vamos continuar em contato e a gente busca essa resposta aqui dentro. De novo, desculpa, gente. Eu estou totalmente na parte de... biologia sintética, então algumas coisas eu realmente não vou saber responder. Mas, por favor, me mandem a pergunta por e-mail que a gente vai atrás.
Tem mais uma, que é a redução de CO2 para CO não poderia ser biológica?
O duro é conseguir fazer isso acontecer. Então, assim, porque apesar do nosso organismo ser um organismo que agora a gente consegue modificar, ele não é muito fácil de modificar. Então, a conclusão que a gente chegou é que o mais fácil, rápido e econômico seria através de eletrólise.
Obrigada. O Luiz Sérgio Carvalho pergunta como podemos produzir etanol a partir de CO2? Qual é a rota do processo?
Seria aquilo que eu mostrei mesmo a partir de eletrólise, usando hidrogênio no processo para chegar no CO e daí no etanol.
Tá certo. Acho que era isso. Muito obrigada novamente. Obrigada a todo mundo que acompanhou a gente pelo Zoom, pelo YouTube.
Imagina, eu que agradeço o convite.
Falaram que te enviaram perguntas pelo LinkedIn, algumas dessas que eu citei.
Ah, legal, eu vou responder todas. Pode ser que demore um pouquinho, uns 2-3 dias, mas eu vou responder, eu prometo.
Tá bom, então, muito obrigada, pessoal, e até semana que vem.
Obrigada.
Até mais. Obrigada, Marilene.
Obrigada, Simone.
Até mais.